If the things start making a 51% of the time they make the right choice and 49% of the wrong, it's going to be a very inefficient system to do all the error correction to correct for that. And so there's this is why we often, you know, the Moore's law, the end of it's being predicted, simply because we are getting down to these tiny, tiny scales. First time I came across integrated circuits was when I was lucky enough to be working many years ago at Acorn, at the time at which Steve Ferber and Roger Wilson were designing the ARM processor. And at that point, we were all very excited about 3-micron technology. That was the feature size of the transistors, 3 microns, which today is huge. And today we're down at, you know, 28 and 22 nanometers. Moore's law is interesting. We've been hearing about it for years. First coined back in the 70s by Gordon Moore of Intel at the time. It was an empirical observation. It was an observation of the number of components that could be built on an integrated circuit and their cost. It's often simply quoted as, you know, every generation we get a doubling in complexity, but it's slightly more nuanced than that. We look at the cost, and I'm going to use a log scale here, so we're going to go 1, 10, 100, 1,000, 10 to the 4, and along here. We'll look at number of components. Moore's observation was over a series of time, we started off, the cost was quite high, and we could integrate, you know, some small number of components, and as you added more and more components, the cost per component went back up. So the point is, there was a sweet spot. There was a size of semiconductor, of integrated semiconductor, that was most cost effective. The first time they looked at this was 1962. What he observed was that at each generation, there was a sweet spot. And that's what's often referred to as Moore's law, is the doubling every generation. And the generation is each time we reduce what we refer to as the feature size of the component. So we reduce the size of the transistor and the wire. And of course, if we have the dimension of it, then because it's a flat surface, we quadruple, multiply by 4 the number of components we get on the chip. First time I came across integrated circuits was when I was lucky enough to be working many years ago at Acorn, at the time at which Steve Ferber and Roger Wilson were designing the ARM processor. And at that point, we were all very excited about 3-micron technology. That was the feature size of the transistors, 3 microns, which today is huge. And today we're down at, you know, 28 and 22 nanometers, much smaller feature size. So what does that actually mean? Maybe it's worthwhile thinking about, you know, how we actually manufacture semiconductors, just to get an understanding of, you know, when we're referring to these, you know, what does this mean? And then some of the issues that we'll get eventually as we shrink these devices smaller and smaller, we'll get to the issues that are causing us concerns about Moore's law and the fact that it's, you know, it's slowing down and it can't continue forever. The original transistors were actually made by just globbing together various bits of semiconductor material. And in fact, there's a brilliant picture you'll be able to find of the first transistor by Schottky when he was at Bell Labs, just showing you how this stuff was glued together. But essentially, to build a transistor, we need some semiconductor materials that are doped with ions that give them either a slightly, a lack of electrons in their crystal structure or an excess of electrons. And they're either referred to as P or N materials. We refer to it as P doping or N doping of the semiconductor material. So when we build silicon chips, taking a cross section of some silicon material, then we dope an area of it with what we refer to as this P material, and then maybe another area with this N material in it. And as we apply an electric charge to this, we switch on and off the current flow through this area of the semiconductor. And that gives us the basic switching function we need. And from that, we can build up all the more complex logic gates. Now, in order to build this, the way we do it is very similar to photography, a process called lithography, where we start with our semiconductor material and we put a mask over the top of it. Then we diffuse in from a gas, lots of our little molecules here flying around, this P-type material. It diffuses into the silicon and that gives us our doped region. And then the next step, a bit similar thing, we start off with our existing region and then we put on a different resistance layer And then we dope it with our N-type material and we build up this small zone. We obviously do it for less time so it doesn't go all the way through. And this process of laying on resist material and then etching it off, the material is photosensitive. We put essentially a negative on top of the chip, shine ultraviolet light through it, and the photoresist reacts under that, and then we can etch it away with some chemical, leaving some of the resist, and then we can dope. And that's very similar to how we've built printed circuit boards for years. It's just at a much smaller scale. So as we want to build smaller and smaller transistors, we've had to understand how to build essentially the masks for the chips. And these masks are multiple layers, including not just the P and the N layers, but also metal layers as well for the wiring on the chip. It's each generation has required better understanding, more complex optical systems, and all sorts of things like that. So that's been going on for years, and that's this same mechanism is the basis of all integrated circuits, whether they're processors, whether they're memory devices. There are subtle distinctions in the details of the layerings and the type of dopings we use that make them more efficient for one use or another. Silicon's not the only material we use for semiconductors. For example, for photonic devices, for lasers, we often use things like gallium arsenide, which is so-called 3-5 semiconductors. So, but it's the basis of all our silicon chips, in essence. Now, as these feature sizes get smaller and smaller, we start getting to the point where if we look at these areas of the transistor, at some point as we shrink this, the question is, how many atoms are there in here, or ions, of the dopant material? And as it gets smaller and smaller, the number gets less and less. And that therein lies one problem, which is as we get to very small numbers of atoms, the behavior we rely upon, the quantum mechanics behavior of the transistor, the probability that it switches in the right way the chances it does the right thing start to reduce. Now, there's always been a problem with any of these systems. There's usually two places in which it's stable, and you're trying to switch from one place to the other. And it's just the probability that these will do the wrong thing. And as we get down to tiny, tiny transistors, there is a serious problem that there aren't many atoms that are actually at the heart of making that decision. And if they don't all decide to jump the same way, then it may not do what we expect. So the prediction of Moore's law that it will run out is a statement of the transistors, starting to do the unlikely thing too often, and the point at which, we've used error correction and other techniques to try to correct the problems that we're getting, that will take us so far. But at some point, if the things start making a 51% of the time they make the right choice and 49% of the wrong, it's going to be a very inefficient system to do all the error correction to correct for that. And so this is why we often, the Moore's law, the end of it's being predicted, simply because we are getting down to these tiny, tiny scales. There's plenty of other things we still have available to us. I mean, many modern chips have vast arrays of the chip that are just laid down to memory arrays. And we can ask questions about, are they the best architectures? Given we have so many billions of transistors, are we doing the best thing with them? And then finally, something that actually dates back a long way as well, I often find myself going back to what seems like prehistory of computing for many, but back in the days when I did my PhD, one of my colleagues did work on 3D chip design, where we stack up the chips on top of each other and hence continue to get doublings in density within a certain area. Doesn't quite get us the same cost savings, but it does give us the ability to build very dense computing systems by stacking. And we've already seen that in a number of commercial products that have come available. Things that can affect this, radiation,
this
for example.
One, only that will fall over, that won't move. Here we go, ready?
Change state and switch from conductor.
Of electrons that it creates. The system works, look at that!
And it's for one of those reasons that, for example, when we build chips to go into satellites or into deep space missions, we take extreme measures to protect the material.